Yeah, thank you for coming early in the morning. I'm going to talk about, so how is this, does this work? Okay, cross-grammar publication repository, cross-linguistic grammatical data. So this is online as of today. Johannes English helps me sort of get this finish the beta version just in time. So it's at the familiar CLLD.org version. So you can go there and browse. So it has 8 contributions at the moment, but hopefully there will be more coming, you know, something like 10 more over the next 2 or 3 months. And then there will be the alpha version. And then I will announce it. But if you announce it earlier, no problem, it's public. So it's, you know, has a familiar CLLD look. So, for example, this is Caio Sinemaki's contribution on the order of core arguments. This is Sandra Auderset's contribution on interrogatives and relativizers, and so on. So, the look has no surprise. There's also example sentences, and again, they look similar to the ones that we had in APIX, and so on. Okay, so Robert told us something about the future, and since I'm one of the two oldest people in this room, I thought I'd also, you know, give us some more historical perspective. Kind of, we already had in Jakob's nice presentation yesterday, we had the Boas and Sapir perspective, but there's actually kind of a really old book from 1926 about the Boas and Sapir time, which is sort of a, you know, both a world atlas of language structures and a sort of glottolog type. So Wilhelm Schmidt, working in Austria at that time, was doing rather similar things even back then, but he didn't have data tables or data sets or so. It was kind of all hand-drawn. Right, this is the map on dual inclusivity. So what is the next history? So in 1976, Crothers published a little article on the distribution of front rounded vowels. But you see, the map was very, very primitive, but that paper really inspired me because he showed that front rounded vowels have a really, you know, surprising aerial distribution. And then Nichols in 1992, in this kind of really important book, you know, she had maps like this. You know, you don't believe it, you know, really, you know, map like this. Without any coastlines and so on. So everything was very primitive at the time. But then since 1978, we actually had more and more data tables. So Nichols in the 92 book has data tables in the Universals of Human Language coming out of Greenberg's Stanford project. We have quite a few data tables. So no maps, but tables. Leon Stassen in his 1997 book had data tables on up to 400 languages. And the generative community, they started doing this. So Cinque, 1999, and Julian, 2002, they list dozens of languages with data tables, but, you know, again, not really reusable, unfair, as Robert would put it. So in 2008, then the online database of WAS came out. Oh, by the way, I kind of brought this physical copy in case some of you actually haven't seen it. So 2005, it came out in this printed version. Clearly, this was the model that we had, and paper publication was still prestigious at that time. It's kind of hard to believe. We had a CD-ROM, so you could kind of put it into your computer. And so the data were available electronically from the start, but on CD-ROM. And then 2008, things really changed when Robert came in and put it all on the web, and as we kind of resolved the copyright issues. So since then, the World Atlas of Language Structures has been an important online resource. It was followed by all kinds of other things Robert already mentioned. There's the APIX, the South American Indian Languages. There's also electronic World Atlas of Varieties of English, in case you hadn't heard about this. It's also a big data set, potentially a lot more users because a lot more people study English. The Foible database, Valency Patterns, Leipzig database. By the way, the person who put this together is Irene Hartmann, who is now Russell's administrator. So that was in her earlier linguist life. Then there's the Syntactic Structures of the World's Languages. It's a completely different community, some generativists in North America. And then there's the Surrey database, also kind of somewhat separate community, the diachronic atlas of comparative linguistics. So there's all these various communities that have these things. Okay, so now we have Grambang, which is much bigger than was, but then what about all these other communities? So actually my thinking is sort of rather similar to Robert's, as you know. And actually Russell yesterday, when he talked about a little bit about the history of Grambang, he mentioned 2010. So it was Russell and Quentin. So, but Steve Levinson was also involved early on. And so my first experience was in 2006. So it was just a year after Waltz had come out. And there was a DGFS annual meeting in Bielefeld. And Steve Levinson gave a plenary talk. And he said, Waltz is wonderful, but it's frustrating, because most of the cells are empty. And I was a bit frustrated about this, because I thought, well, I mean, is the glass half full or half empty? For me, it was kind of very full. So, but I could see that you could have a sort of different perspective. So that's fine. So now the glass is no longer half empty, but half full, but it's still missing data, right? So, you know, we've had, you know, then after the Waltz database became more widely available, quite a few of these papers kind of using Waltz data, you know, Lupien and Dale based on Waltz data, Atkins in 2011, Dunn et al. 2011. So, but we also have seen, and yesterday this came up to some extent, that some of these papers are perhaps not as robust as we might have hoped, you know, Sean Roberts mentioned. So is it only the amount of data that really, really helps us? I'm not so sure. So I'm not so super optimistic. So in addition to the top-down data collection, I think it's kind of also important to have sort of community source data, so that we get a kind of broad community of people who are interested in cross-linguistic data, who think about them, so that we have a substantial community of people who kind of feel that they're part of the enterprise of large-scale language comparison. The key idea is to collect the cross-linguistic data that are anyway available in appendixes and supplements. So, you know, if you, you know, just look at papers, you know, this was published in Stuff, Language Typology and Universals, you know, not a very prestigious journal, but it's a kind of nice study on classificatory properties of names with an appendix in the PDF file. Sandra Audaset has a very nice study on interrogatives, its relativization markers in Indo-European. So there's an Excel file in the supplement. She also has some maps, but they're not interactive. Matthew Dreyer, 2018, a really large scale study on the order of demonstrative numeral adjective and noun. And he actually has a 150-page PDF supplement. So all the data are there, but it's a 150-page PDF. It's kind of not really sort of table or so. So very idiosyncratic way they sort of accepted it. He also has his kind of handmade maps. And so you can look at some stuff in the supplement. But of course, we want this data accessible in a kind of nicer way. So we want something like CrossGram, an interactive repository using the CLID software, including all the functionality known from the other CLID project, the CC BY license, data available for easy download in CLDF format. And Johannes English joined me about a year ago and helped me make progress on this. So we have these eight initial contributions. One, for example, Johanna Nichols, her data from 1992, so she has there's all these tiny print data at the end. And Mikael Parkwall, actually from Stockholm, had an Excel version of this and sent it to me. Johanna didn't have it. So, but she was, of course, very happy that we put this online. And so there's some kind of earlier papers like Kaius's from 2010 or Kira Tracing from 2013. So this is just about Papuan languages. So you know, it doesn't have to be worldwide, but it has to be lots of languages, lots of features. So, you know, at least 100 data points or something like that. So, you know, what does it look like? Well, you know, each contribution has a kind of introduction, languages, language parameters, sources, potentially examples. So Corinna Hanschu's names and nominal classification has 51 languages, not a very big data set, but still it's kind of nicely browsable. So she has 4 language parameters. So, you know, for each of the parameters, you can click on the more button and then you see the value table, and you can look at the worldwide map. And, you know, it's not spectacular, but it's much, much better than the appendix in the PDF. So that would be the appendix. And of course, you know, you can, you know, look at each language, change the background, whatever. Matthew Dreyer's contribution on the order of demonstrative numeral adjective. And now we have a kind of a lot more stuff. There's 1,000 languages here. There's 10 parameters. So the maps look a lot more impressive. In the walls data set, we had a restriction because we emphasized human readability, that we didn't want to have more than 9 different feature values. And here, that's not so important. You know, you can also kind of manipulate these different feature values. You know, the map is confusing in this way, but in the online version, you can, you know, just choose a few and then focus on those. And so here there's really no limit on the number of values that you could have. So in Daniel Audaset's contribution, just to give you a sense of the kinds of things that we can do, this is just about Indo-European. So family column is rather uniform here. But in addition to the language parameters, we also languages and language parameters, we also have constructions and construction parameters. That's a special thing here. So there's actually only one language parameter, and the parameter is what is the form of the relative marker, right? So you don't get different colors, you just get this form, and they can see the Bulgarian relative marker is deto or koito or koyato and so on. And you can see all the forms, not different colors, but still a very helpful thing. And then there's 150 constructions for these 99 languages. And these cannot be presented on a map, but we can have construction parameters and right. And for the parameters, again, see the data tables. I don't have this here, but you can browse it yourself. Okay, so we have overall for the entire project, all 8 contributions that are there right now, 2,600 languages, which can be browse in the usual way. We have 76 language parameters across the different contributions. We have 150 constructions. The data sets are supposed to be available on Zenodo. That is not the case yet in this beta version. So far, they're still on GitHub because we are still making a few changes. But that is kind of the idea. Okay, so that kind of brings me to the end of this part, but I have like 5 more minutes or so. So, you know, looking a bit more at the future, I've been thinking about ways of making comparative concepts commensurable across data sets. This is not part of this yet, but it's sort of an idea that I have, and I've talked about this in various occasions, and so I like to use just a few more minutes to tell you about it. So we want to make comparisons possible across data sets such as Walls Saves, SSWL, you know, and also the various data sets in CrossGram. So we have the order of subject, object, and verb in Walls. We have dominant constituent order and transitive clause in Sales. That's just the South American Indian languages. The order of subject, object, and verb in APEX. These data sets were collected independently. And so it would be really interesting to sort of put them together and compare them and so on. At the moment, that can only be done manually. All right, here's another one from the syntactic structures of the world's languages. I don't know how live this project is. It was these generativists at NYU, and I think at some point they kind of lost interest, but they were inspired by what we had been doing at some time, and it's still online, but I'm not sure if it's being curated. So, you know, just like for comparison of lexical databases, we have the Concepticon, lexical comparison across languages. You know, many of you know this website, and if you don't know it, then look at it. It's really amazing resource. So that really inspired me to think in the direction of a grammaticon. So Robert already mentioned that yesterday. So okay, right. These are a few more slides about the concepticon. So the counterpart would be grammaticon to facilitate comparison of different grammatical data sets. So analogous to the lexical comparison meanings in the concepticon, the concept sets, it would contain meta features which capture what is common in highly similar features in different databases. So we saw these different features across WALS, APEX, SAILS, DIACL, and SSWL. These kind of saw these. And so the meta feature would be, formulated in kind of some kind of regimented standard language, dominant order and transit clauses is AVP, right? Sort of using A and P as a kind of standard concepts and typology. Then it would sort of link to these. I had this idea sometime five, 6 years ago or so, and I haven't made so much progress, but I thought I'd just mention it again because that will also motivate me more to work on this further. Again, inclusive, exclusive distinction, independent pronouns, no inclusive, exclusive, and so on. And then the meta feature would be no inclusivity, distinction, independent personal pronouns. Okay, so that was just a kind of a little view of the future, and that really brings me to an end, and maybe you have some questions.